We shall start. So previous class we were discussing this theorem that a point satisfies ZA equal to MT. This is equivalent to saying that there exists lambda I greater than equal to 0 and WJ in R such that grad L is 0 and lambda I GI at A is 0 for all I. Okay. So we wanted to prove, actually we were halfway through. Anyway, if you remember, ZA is nothing but the set of all T such that first this point has to belong to the linearizing cone. So that basically means grad GI transpose T has to be greater than or equal to 0 for all active GI, and then grad HJ transpose T, this is equal to 0, not this, this is equal to 0 for all J. For all J means 1 to P. And plus grad F A transpose T is less than 0. This is ZA. So it is basically talking about the set of all directions in the linearizing cone for which grad F A transpose D is less than 0. So assume that this is equal to MT. So what does this mean? This means whenever T is in the linearizing cone, we have grad F A transpose T is greater than or equal to 0. This is what it means. Now, if you want to write down the first one would look like, so here, let us assume what are the active GI. Let's say for simplicity, assume G1 to GK are active. So then D is in the linearizing cone. This basically means this one. Grad G1 A transpose up to grad GK transpose. I am not writing A. This is the first part. And then you will have grad H1 transpose up to grad HP transpose. This matrix, I am writing down this matrix. And then the negative minus grad H1 transpose minus grad HP transpose. All these things are evaluated at A. Okay. This times D has to be greater than or equal to 0. So what I have done, I have converted grad HJ transpose D equal to 0 into greater than 0 and minus of that, greater than 0, less than 0, less than 0 is being written in the minus form. Okay. So D belongs to DA means this, and this implies grad F transpose D is greater than or equal to 0. So this one looks like the Farkas lemma statement, where Farkas lemma statement was so this one looks like this one, that B transpose D greater than equal to 0 implies C transpose D is greater than equal to 0. So then there was the equivalent of Farkas lemma. Okay, so then Farkas lemma would say that if you call this as B transpose, so then Farkas lemma would say that there exists y greater than equal to 0 such that C transpose, what is C transpose here? Now C transpose is our grad F transpose. So let me write that grad F transpose is actually equal to Y transpose B transpose. This one is B transpose, okay? Which in another word, in other words, grad F is equal to BY. And what is B? Now this is the transpose. So what is B? B would look like this. So grad F is equal to, you write down B. What is B? Now this is grad G1 up to grad GK. And then grad H1 up to grad HP. And then minus grad H1 up to minus grad HP. This matrix multiplied by Y. So that is Y1. This Y will have how many entries? Now Y will have 2P plus K entries. Okay. Y1, Y2, YK, then YK plus 1 to YK plus P, and finally YK plus 2P. That you will have. Okay. So now, if write down that, so that is equal to, remember y is greater than equal to 0. So you can write down this actually as y1 grad g1 plus yk grad gk plus what amount of grad h1? This will be yk plus 1 minus y K plus P plus 1 multiplied by grad H1. Okay. Similarly, you will do that plus Y K plus P minus Y K plus 2P grad HP. I can write it in that way also. I just like took this grad H1 common. So grad H1, grad H2. Okay. Now notice that, so you can actually then write this as lambda 1 times grad G1. Well, what is lambda 1? Lambda 1 is Y1 only. Plus lambda K times grad GK. Plus this you write as W1. So lambda is lambda 1 to lambda K, they are greater than equal to 0. This I am writing as W1 grad H1. What is W1? W1 is a real number because it is the difference of two non-negative numbers. So I don't know, it is a real number that you can easily say. So that is what it is. WP grad HP. Okay. So here what I have now, lambda 1 to lambda K, they are greater than equal to 0 and WI belonging to R. Fine. In fact, I can even extend this to a little bit more. I can write this as lambda 1 grad G1 plus dot 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 lambda K grad GK plus 0 times grad GK plus 1 plus dot 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 plus 0 times grad GM. Okay, so all those I can write with a coefficient 0. So this new lambda is R remaining, it is the same thing, and plus the W part here. So what is it now? So therefore I have shown that there exist lambda is greater than equal to 0 such that grad F is equal to summation lambda I grad gi plus evaluated at a only plus summation wj grad hj, where I mean in beginning actually I should have said there exists lambda I greater than or equal to 0 and wj belong to, that is what we proved. This existence came from the existence of the vector y greater than or equal to 0 due to Farkas lemma. Plus, where, what do you see? Now, I see that lambda I, for any I, lambda I gi evaluated at a equal to 0. What is actually happening is that for I equal to 1 to k, the gi's were active, so therefore gi a was 0, so that product will be 0. And when I is not, I mean, gi is not active, so it is positive. But then for those not active constants, I have taken the coefficients, the lambda i's actually. So this is lambda 1, lambda k. This is lambda k plus 1. This is being taken as lambda k plus 1. And this is being taken as lambda m. Okay. So those coefficients I have taken to be 0. So this is satisfied for all I. Okay. So that is the proof. A implies B. The proof is that. Okay. This is where I have written it. You can see that. And what about B implies A? Now B implies A says, suppose that you have there exists lambda I and wj such that this is satisfied. Okay. And then you want to show that ja is equal to empty. Well, the best way to show is to show that grad f transpose d becomes positive for each d in da. So in that case, da will automatically be empty. Now for each d in da, what is d in da? Now da means what? Now this is the set of all d such that what do you have? Grad gi transpose d is greater than or equal to 0 for all active constraints, and grad hj transpose d is equal to 0 for all hj. That is the part of a linearizing cone, okay, for all hj. Now so and what by assumption of b, what I know is that grad f, there exists lambda I greater than or equal to 0, this is summation lambda I grad g I plus summation wj grad hj. So there exists, this is by assumption of b, there exists lambda I greater than or equal to 0 wj in r such that this happens. Okay, the first term you divide it into two parts, lambda I grad g I. You can put a transpose, but I will put a transpose later. You can put transpose, it's okay. And here this is corresponding to active, all gi that are active, plus write the same thing, lambda I grad gi transpose. This is inactive. Active and inactive are always talked about the inequality constant, gi, not about the equality constants. Equality constants anyway, I mean, they are passing through. Okay. Now, what about the active constraints? Now, according to the active, like for active constraints, I do have grad gi transpose d greater than or equal to 0. So I multiply by d, I multiply by d, I multiply by d, multiply by d, here also, here also. Now this one is greater than or equal to 0 because d is taken from the linearizing cone. What about the second term? Now for the second term, you remember when gi is inactive, a small deduction you have to do. Gi inactive implies gi, this means gi a is greater than 0, right? But then you have been given by the assumption of b, you have been given that lambda I gi a is equal to 0. So this forces, this is given. And so you get lambda I equal to 0 for inactive. Okay. And therefore, this will be equal to 0. This sum will be equal to 0. And grad Hj transpose D is equal to 0. That is over here. So that is equal to 0. So in total, it is greater than or equal to 0. Okay. So that is what I wanted to show. Taking D from the linearizing cone, grad F transpose D is equal to greater than or equal to 0. So therefore, Za will be empty. Okay. Fine. You can see the proof later. Now, given that Za is equal to empty, is an equivalent condition, has an equivalent condition that there is a feasible point at which you can find lambda I greater than or equal to 0, Wj real such that grad L equal to 0 with the condition that lambda I gi equal to 0. See, this is at A. Anywhere I am saying lambda I gi equal to 0, this means at A. Like at every point I will have to write A. So at many places I forget to write A. So please remember that. Okay. So in view of this, okay, so the a feasible point, so actually a point is called a Kuhn-Tucker point, KT point in short, if it satisfies those three conditions, that is, it is a feasible point, and then those conditions that was mentioned in B, that there exists lambda I greater than or equal to 0, Wj in R, such that grad L is 0 and lambda I gi at A is equal to 0 for all I, all these. It is called a Kuhn-Tucker point. Okay. So what are these? Now, in view of the previous result, what you know is that at a point A, if A is a KT point, then I know that ZA is empty. Okay, what does it, ZA is, what does it mean, ZA is empty? Now for every linearizing cone direction, I see that the grad F, I mean the directional derivative of F in that direction is greater than or equal to 0. Oh, that gives me a sense that this may be possible local minimums. Okay, so these Kuhn-Tucker points are nothing but these are some possible local minimums. Okay. So therefore, finding Kuhn-Tucker points becomes important. Okay. So the idea is that I will find Kuhn-Tucker points, and I will have a theorem that whenever the regularity conditions are satisfied, a point of local minimum must be a Kuhn-Tucker point. So then it is basically the same way that I was finding critical points and trying to test some sufficient condition whether it is a local minimum or not. Similarly here, I will be trying to find the Kuhn-Tucker points. Okay, then how do you find the Kuhn-Tucker points? under what condition the local minimum will be Kuntakar points necessarily, that part will come later. At least, I mean, for the time being, how to find Kuntakar points. So imagine a situation where I have to minimize x minus y plus z subject to, this is the unit cube with one corner at origin and the other corner at 1, 1, 1, and intersection a plane x plus y plus z, x plus 2y plus 3z equal to 3, that plane. Okay. So that is my T. T is that. I want to minimize x minus y plus z. Okay, fine enough. No problem over there. Acha. By the way, every time, everywhere we have meant R plus means origin included, H plus means closed half space. Everywhere, Z plus, if we write, it means zero included. You still, even yesterday, some of you still confused. Okay. So it is better you remember these things. Huh? And this is very standard. Most of the textbook would follow this. You remember, if I want to be strict, I will say R plus interior, H plus interior. Remember that? So keeping that in mind, depending on the text also, like at least we are following this. Okay. Okay. Yeah. So I want to find out the KT points. So here is a problem given. I want to find out the KT points. What do I do? Anyway, there are two ways. The first way is like the geometric way. I will have to draw the things and see and tell you. Okay. What is the geometric way? Now, the geometric way is via the linearizing cone. Of course, via the linearizing cone. So that means I have to show that I have to use the fact that ZA equal to MT at a point, at a KT point. Okay. So let us first visualize. You remember this one, na? So visualize the feasible region. Where is it drawn? This is where it is drawn. Okay. So this was, as you remember, it was the, G1 was 1 minus x, that is x less than equal to 1. G2, 1 minus y greater than equal to 0. G3, one minus z greater than equal to 0, and then G4 is x greater than equal to 0, G5 y greater than equal to 0, and G6 z greater than equal to 0, and h was x plus 2y plus 3z minus 3 equal to 0. So we write it in this way. That is the format. So we first write it in that style. Okay, but it was given. Like, had I given that x, y, z point belongs to this unit cube and also lies on the plane x plus 2y plus 3z equal to 3, then the first step for you is to write it in this way. Okay, that is done. Okay. Now you consider any point. So there are many this thing. You observe the line joining. Observe the line joining 0, 0, 1 to 0, 1, 1 third. Okay. That line joining. You take any point which is not on the line. Okay. You take any point on that plate, but not on that line segment. Okay, not on that line segment. So suppose you have taken any point somewhere here. So once you have taken somewhere here, so it must have the first coordinate positive. Because it have the first coordinate positive, so you can go a little bit left. You can decrease the first coordinate. Okay, you can go a little bit left. You can decrease the first coordinate. So in that case, what will happen? Now what direction you are going? Now I am trying to decrease the first coordinate. What about the second coordinate? That is the y coordinate. Now y coordinate I will not change. So I will remain as such, whatever it is. So at whatever point, so I am trying to go in this direction. I want to decrease the first coordinate. So direction would be minus one. That's fine. No problem. And I do not want to touch the second coordinate. That will be done. And I will have to take some appropriate third coordinate, z. And I want to move on the plate. If I am trying to move on the plate, finding a direction on the plate, that must satisfy the condition that it must be normal to the normal of that plane, right? It must be perpendicular to that. So that will, so this will imply z is equal to 1/3. So that is the direction that I am trying to move is minus 1/0, 1/3. So consider this direction, minus 1/0, 1/3. That means you are not changing this thing. You are only changing, going left in x-axis. According to y-axis, you are not doing anything. You are at the same this thing. Only the, z value will increase a little bit because the plane is inclined down. So if you are going left, you will increase, go up a little bit. That's okay. But what happens for this direction? Remember grad f? Grad f was x minus y plus z. I think that was the function. Yeah, x minus y plus z. So grad f was 1 minus 1 plus 1. So if I take the grad f in a product with d, what do I get? Now I get grad f transpose d is equal to minus 2/3, and which is negative. And therefore, it follows that for any point A over here, z A is not empty. There is, here is a direction I am giving you. Here is a direction along which, the grad f in a product D is, negative. Here is a direction. So therefore, this point A, any such point A, fails to be a KT point. Okay. Next, you take any point A over here. Here means on the line segment, it can be any point, just leave the point 0, 1, 1/3. Okay. Take any point on the line segment, on that line segment, take any point A on the line segment other than 0, 1, 1/3. In that case, what will happen? A direction is available in that, on that line segment to go towards 0, 1, 1/3. What is that direction? I am standing at A, the second A, not the first A. Okay. I'm standing at A. So you can call this as A cap or, okay. I am standing at this A cap and I want to move in the direction of 0, 1, 1/3 on that plane. So what am I doing? Am I changing X? No, I am not changing X. So this direction will be 0. X I am not changing. What about Y? What am I doing with Y? Now I am increasing Y. Whatever is the y value, it is going towards 1. So I am increasing y. So y will be something. Let me put 1. A direction. It is just a direction going that. But it has to lie on that plane. Because it has to lie on that plane, this inner product D, this 1, 2, 3, that normal of that plane, inner product D has to be satisfied. So 1, 2, 3, so this has to be taken what, because I have got 2, so I will have to take minus 2 by 3. If I take minus 2 by 3, then 1, 2, 3 inner product, this one, 0, 1, minus 2 by 3, that will give me 0. So that is fine. So that is the direction available here. So that will be this direction. That will be this direction. And you can see that because the value of Z is decreasing, so it has to go down that way. Okay. And why not? I mean, if you want to find out the, actually that is the slope only, na? 0 minus 0, that is fine. And then 1 minus 0, that is 1, that is the y coordinate. And then 1 by 3 minus 1, that is the difference of x coordinate, I mean z coordinate, that is minus 2 by 3. Okay, no problems. So that is the direction, that is a feasible direction available over here. What about grad f transpose this d? You call, if you call this d cap, no problem. What about grad f transpose d cap? Now grad f transpose d cap would be like minus 1 and then minus 2 by 3 at a cap is equal to minus 5 by 3. So that is also negative. Okay. So what does that say? Now it says that any of these points, so that means at those points, what we get that z of a cap is not equal to empty, and therefore these points also cannot be Kuntaker points. So what point remains? Now the only point that remains is 0, 1, 1 third. Okay. At 0, 1, 1 third, what are the directions available? At 0, 1, 1 third, that is the corner. What are the directions available? These are the directions available, right? You will have these directions. Okay, that's what is visible. But what do I mean by these are the directions available? A little bit in letters. Now the so I am taking now the case a equal to 0, 1, 1 third. So what directions are available? Now directions available here. Okay. See what is happening. The x coordinate is 0. All you can do is that you can at best increase the x coordinate. You cannot go down. So direction will be available here. That is like d1 will be greater than equal to 0. What about y coordinate? Now y coordinate is already 1. All the best you can do is whatever y you will go, you can only have, it is less than equal to 0. Y coordinate can only decrease. So d2 less than equal to 0. And what about d3? No, d1, d2, d3, they have to satisfy the condition. What condition do they have to satisfy? Now they have to be normal to 1, 2, 3. That is, I mean, the d has to lie on the plane, right? D3, where, what is D3? Now they have to, like, where the normal to the plane multiplied by D1, D2, D3 has to be equal to 0. So this basically means D3 is equal to minus D1 minus 2 D2. So I have essentially D is equal to D1 greater than equal to 0, D2 less than equal to 0, and minus D1, three times D3 is that, so I have to divide it by 3. Okay, divide it by 3. Minus 2 D2 divided by 3. This is 2, huh? These are the possible directions available at 0, 1, 1 third. Essentially, if you see, this is equal to, this is the cone generated by, if you take 1, 0 minus 1/3 and 0 minus 1/2. Okay. That is the cone generated by. So for the first one, I take D1 equal to 1, D2 equal to 0. And then I get that. And I remember that D2 can only be negative. So I take D2 equal to minus 1. And then what do I get? This is 2/3. Okay. So these are all the directions that are available over here. If you remember a problem that we did, that when the constraints are all linear, then this is dA. Okay. dA is equal to the linearizing cone at A. It's the same thing, which is the closure of dA, and that is equal to the linearizing cone. Okay, this is the linearizing cone. Same as the linearizing cone. Okay, those are the linearizing cone. Fine. And what is that I want? Now I wanted to verify whether that is a Kuntakar point. What does that mean? Now in the geometric way I was trying, and so essentially I wanted to see if ZA equal to empty. What does it mean by ZA equal to empty? Now, for all directions in the linearizing cone, I want to check whether grad F transpose D is greater than equal to 0. Oh, acha. Since you have already written the linearizing cone is the cone generated by these two vectors, 1, 0, minus 1 by 3, and 0, minus 1, 2 by 3. Okay. Now, why don't you check, take the grad F with both of them, and since it is a cone, once they are positive, the for all direction in D, that will be positive. Okay. If that is the case, what is grad F? Now, grad F was, grad F transpose was 1 minus 1, 1. So 1 minus 1, 1 transpose with the first vector, that is fine. And grad F transpose, okay, like have I made some computational mistakes? Okay, this one with the first vector is fine. Of course, it is fine. This is equal to 2 by 3. And this one with the second vector. Now this one with the second vector, 1 minus 1, 1 with the second vector, that is 5 by 3. So that is also fine. 0 minus 1, 2 by 3. And so that is equal to 5 by 3. That is also positive. And therefore, if I take lambda times D1 and cone means non-negative combinations of these two vectors. Na? This vector v1 and this vector v2. So any direction I have already understood that it is lambda times v1 plus mu times v2, where lambda and mu are non-negative. So there also it will remain greater than equal to 0. And so for any non-negative combinations, of V1 and V2, we have any non-negative combination D of V1 and V2, we have grad F transpose D is greater than equal to 0. So that shows ZA equal to empty. So A is a Kuntakar point. What is the A under consideration? Now it is 0, 1, 1/3. Okay. Okay, fine, these are the things that I have written over here. I only want to right, this is the cone generated by these two vectors, fine. And so it will be done. Okay. All right. That part. So the question was here up to this. So only this is the only QWERTY point we concluded, and this was the geometric way. Okay. But if you wanted to compute the mechanical way, because that is the reason why QWERTY points were introduced. Okay. So we do the algebraic way. What is the algebraic way? Now, algebraic way means I am recalling what were my constraints and what was f. So the algebraic way is like this. Suppose that a feasible point A is a QWERTY point. Okay, like actually I should not say that a feasible, suppose that A is a QWERTY point, because by QWERTY point definition A is feasible point, but it makes you like the English very lyrical, it makes, but it is better to avoid actually, because it will create a doubt what by definition of QWERTY point it is not a feasible point or what. That kind of confusion will come. So suppose that A is a QWERTY point, it means A is a feasible point, it satisfies that lambda I w, lambda I greater than equal to 0, w j real, such that grad L equal to 0, and so here, such that grad L equal to 0. Grad L equal to 0 means what? Now it is grad F is equal to this much. What is grad F here? Now F is equal to x minus fx, yz is x minus y plus z. So grad F, remember grad F is a column, and this is the column vector. Grad F is 1 minus 1, 1, and that should be equal to lambda 1 times grad g1. What is grad g1? Now minus 1, 0, 0 plus lambda 2 times 0 minus 1, 0 plus lambda 3 times 0, 0 minus 1 plus lambda 4 times. Lambda 4 is x, huh? I mean that g4 is x, so it is 1, 0, 0. What this 1, 0, 0 I am writing? Now this is grad g4 evaluated at A. Okay. Plus lambda 5 times 0, 1, 0 plus lambda 6 times 0, 0, 1 plus w times grad hj is 1, 2, 3. Okay. By definition, so I am saying suppose A is a QWERTY point, then there exists lambda I greater than equal to 0, w belong to R with lambda I gi A equal to 0. For all I, of course, such that this is satisfied. This has to be the case. Okay. Now from here, how do I get QWERTY points? Now from here, one will have to find out somehow, deduce that, deduce something. Try to do that. Here also nobody guides, but like it is a little better than the geometric one, simply because there are places where you may not be able to see geometry. Okay, so here, for example, notice the second coordinate of the vectors. So the second coordinate of grad f is minus 1, and a negative, since all lambda is are greater than or equal to 0, a negative can only come from lambda 2, from here. Lambda 2, 0, minus 1, 0. Everybody else has second coordinate greater than or equal to 0. So it follows that lambda 2 is positive. Must be positive, because if lambda 2 is 0, if you make lambda 2 0, then you will never get second coordinate minus 1. Okay, so it follows that must lambda 2 be greater than or equal to 0? Yes, lambda 2 must be greater than or equal to 0. Yes, that is true. And what does it mean? Now, because lambda 2 is greater than or equal to 0, it means G2A has to be equal to 0. So this implies G2A has to be equal to 0. This basically means A is star 1 star. A has second coordinate 1, pakka. Okay. That's what it means. And not only that, because A has second coordinate 1, it automatically means that G4 is not satisfied. G4 is not active. Okay. I mean, in any case, so second coordinate. So lambda 5. Okay. Since A has second coordinate this, what about lambda 5 G5 of A? Now, what is G5 of A? Now, G5 of A is equal to 1. That is the Y value only. G5 is Y value only. You can see. So, because that is 1, it automatically means lambda 5 equal to 0. So, one equation down. One factor down. I found out that lambda 5 is equal to 0. I also found out that the second term, second coordinate of A has to be 1. Okay, that's what we have found. Okay. We found that lambda 2 greater than 0. We found that A2, the second coordinate, has to be equal to 1. And we also concluded that lambda 5 is equal to 0. Next. Can we have lambda 3 positive? Now, see, if you have lambda 3 positive, then what will mean? Then it will mean that Z equal to 1. Right, because if lambda 3 is positive, then from the equation that lambda 3 G3 of A equal to 0, lambda 3 is positive, so G3A has to be 0. But G3A is 1 minus Z. 1 minus Z is equal to 0 means Z equal to 1, the third coordinate is 1. If lambda 3 is greater than 0, okay, if lambda 3 is greater than 0, okay, I am simply writing that way, then this means, and this would imply A3 has to be equal to 1. Okay, but will it satisfy? Remember, A is a feasible point, because it is given to be a KT point. So the star is a non-negative number between 0 and 1. Ultimately, you satisfy everything is there between 0 and 1. So if I take 1 times this, 1 times this, 2 times the second coordinates, and 3 times the third coordinate, will it be equal to 3? No, it is at least 5. So that means in that case, A does not satisfy the H condition. Okay, that is the H condition. So why writing H1? Write better H. Anyway, so this is not possible, does not belong to T, as A is not on the, it does not satisfy H1 condition. Okay, as simple is going meet out as H1 A is not equal to 0. That's it. Okay. So lambda 3 cannot be positive. So that means lambda 3 is equal to 0. Another one down. Okay. Fine. So I have got lambda 3 equal to 0. Fine enough. So now I am asking, can lambda 1 be positive? Okay. You'll have to see differently. Let's see. See, if lambda 1 is positive, what does it mean? The same style. Now, in the same style, if lambda 1 is positive, lambda 1 positive would imply, now from there, using this will imply, let me not write this, this is not correct. This is not correct actually. This is using, I said. Using this, you get this. Okay. Similarly, I am saying what I will use over here. Now you will use lambda 1 g1 A equal to 0. But then lambda 1 is positive, it will mean that g1 A is equal to 0. So this will mean that x is equal to 1, because g1 was 1 minus x. So because x is equal to 1, it will also mean that lambda 4 is equal to 0, because lambda 4 g4 is lambda 4 times x is already 1, so that equal to 0 means lambda 4 equal to 0. Okay, so if lambda 1 is equal to 0, then I will get 1 minus 1 grad f is a linear combination, is a non-negative combination of lambda 1. I will have lambda 2. Lambda 4 will be 0 for that. And I will have lambda 6 and I will have w. Okay. So this is the equation. 1 minus 1, 1 is equal to lambda 1 minus 1, 0, 0. Lambda 2, 0 minus 1, 0. Lambda 6 I have. Lambda 4 has evaporated under the assumption that lambda 1 greater than 0, I have lambda 4 equal to 0. So that term has gone. What is only remaining is lambda 6 and w. Okay. Now in that case, notice that Now notice what is the value of w that I have to choose. Look at the first coordinate. Okay. And tell what value of w I have to choose. Now the value of w is at least greater than equal to 1. Actually w is equal to 1 plus lambda 1 only. Because you will have 1 plus lambda 1 and then lambda 1 with minus 1 minus lambda 1, that will cancel away and ultimately you will have 1. So W, the value of W, actually W is equal to 1 plus lambda 1, which is greater than or equal to 1. It is actually greater than 1, but doesn't matter. But then if W is bigger than 1, then 3W will be bigger than or equal to 3. And then lambda 6 is positive, so the third coordinate cannot be equal to 1. Okay. So first you look at the first coordinate. Looking at the first coordinate, I observe that W equal to 1 plus lambda 1, which is greater than or equal to 1. Now in that case, the third coordinate will not get satisfied. Okay. So therefore, this is not possible. That is lambda 1 greater than or equal to greater than 0 is not possible. Okay. So therefore, that also goes. Lambda 1 equal to 0. I conclude now that therefore lambda 1 is equal to 0. So only these three remain. Okay. Lambda 2, lambda 4, lambda 6, and W, of course. Okay. So lambda 1 equal to 0. Lambda 2, lambda 4, lambda 6, and W. That is what is remaining. Now I am trying to figure out. Okay. Now, can W be greater than 1/3? Now look, if W is greater than 1/3, I am looking at the third coordinate. W is greater than 1/3, then this 3W will be bigger than 1. And then lambda 6 can only be positive, so the third coordinate will not get satisfied. So answer is no. Okay. W cannot be. So then what it means? Now it means, therefore, W has to be less than or equal to 1/3. Okay. Now, because W is less than equal to 1/3, you see this. So looking at the first coordinate, look at the first coordinate. It follows that lambda 4 is at least 2/3. So lambda 4 is positive. Okay. Fine. So lambda 4 is greater than or equal to 0. So lambda 4 is greater than lambda 4 is positive. But then what about this lambda 4 G4A? Now lambda 4 G4A, lambda 4 is X. Okay. So that is positive. This basically says X is equal to 0. That is the first coordinate of the point is 0. Second coordinate we already know 1, but we also know that this lies on the plane x plus 2y plus 3z equal to 3. So this has to be 1/3. If at all there is a KT point, this has to be it with this deduction. Okay. But whether this is a KT point or not, now for this point, I will have to supply lambda h and all these things. Now for this point, I supply the lambda h. What are the lambda h that I already have supplied? I have supplied lambda 1 is equal to 0, lambda 5 equal to 0, lambda 3 equal to 0, that I have supplied. I will supply, after looking a little bit, I will supply W equal to 1/3. Let me check. W equal to 1/3. And then lambda 4 equal to 2/3. And since W equal to 1/3, I do not know what I will. I shall take lambda 6. I can take lambda 6 to be. This is already giving me 1. So lambda 6, I take 0. Because W is already, I am taking 1/3. So 3W is already 1. And the final has to be 1. Lambda 6, I have to take 0. I am taking 0, no problem. Lambda 1, lambda 6, this thing. And lambda 2, of course, lambda 2. What is 2W? Now this is 2/3. And lambda 2 times 1, so that has to be given. So lambda 2 has to be equal to 5/3. So then 2/3 minus 5/3 is minus. It satisfies the equation. So therefore, If I take A equal to this, lambda equal to as given, W equal to as given, I see that this point A is a point of, is it a feasible point? Now, yes, it is a feasible point. It is there in T. Yes, it is there in T. Is grad L equal to 0 here? Yes, grad L equal to 0. And is lambda I gi equal to 0 for all I? Now the answer is yes. So therefore, this is a KT point. And then just practice this with one exercise, and then few questions are given here. We'll have a class tomorrow. Tomorrow is a Friday, so we'll have a class at 3. It is over now. If you have any questions, you ask.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
I had a doubt in the starting when you were concluding lambda 2 greater than 0.